I'm going to discuss some of the ideas behind root finding algorithms. So the first one we're going to consider is bisection. Bisection is a pure process. There's no real maths behind it. And you'll recall that you start with two bracketing points, A and B, such that the function at point A multiplied by the function at point B is less than zero. And what that means is that f of A and f of b have opposite signs. So if we are trying to find a root for a function, let's say that looks a little bit like this, here's x, here's f of x, and here's our function going through here, then if we put our two points a and b here and here, so this is a and this is b, we are either side of the root, we have bracketed it. And then the bisection algorithm simply tells you to evaluate C, which is halfway between A and B, and then that will give you a value F of C, and you replace either A or B with C, depending on the sign of F of A of C. So if FA multiplied by f of c is greater than zero, they have the same sign, and so you replace a with c. And if f of b multiplied by f of c is greater than zero, then you replace b with c, and you repeat until you reach some tolerance. So there's not really any maths there, it's just a simple heuristic approach, but it guarantees to find the root, and more importantly, it guarantees to keep the root bracketed. There's no point at which we are going to lose sight of the root. A and B are always going to be either side. And I'll show another video where I'll do this in Python interactively. So the other root finding algorithms that we're thinking about are the secant and the Newton-Raphson approaches. And really, they're the same idea. Got tangled up with Raphson there. They both assume some kind of linear fit, and they use that to find the root. Of course, the point is that the way that they get the linear fit is different. So what we're going to do is we're going to assume that y of x is equal to some gradient m, and then we're going to multiply that into x minus x0, where x0 is a point we'll come to in a moment, and then we add on f of x0. Okay, so what does this mean? Well, that means that if x is equal to x0, then y is equal to f of x0, which is exactly what we want, and then the values of y at other points will be simply a linear interpolation. If we're using the secant method, then what we're going to find is that we're going to have two points. We always start with two points in the secant method, which are going to be x0 and x1. And for the secant method, the gradient m is going to be f of x1 minus f of x0, f of x0 divided by x1 minus x0, which you can also write as, let's say, delta f over delta x. And if we draw our curve here again, here is going to be our x1, here is going to be our x0. So let's change the color here to green, and we're going to see that actually what we have is a dotted line that should be a straight line, and our new point is going to be exactly here. So that's going to be our assumption for where the root is, and obviously the closer you get to the root, the better this linear approximation is going to be, and therefore it should converge. Now, if we assume, if we're going to interpolate to the point where y is equal to zero, because that's where we cross the x-axis, let me put f and x here. So if y is equal to zero, then what we have is that m into x minus x naught is equal to minus f of x naught. That's just taking this equation up here, putting y equal to naught and moving the f of x to the other side. And we can then expand out, and so we can say that x is equal to x naught minus f of x naught divided by m. Okay, so what I did was I took the m and put it underneath the f of x naught, and then I just shifted the x zero to the other side there. That's the general formula for both the secant method and the Newton-Raphson method. In the secant method, as I've shown you, we are writing the gradient here, and we need 2 points. Notice that, importantly, with the secant, we cannot guarantee that we bracket the root. We do not maintain the bracketing. And that can cause problems, particularly if the gradient is small, we're dividing by a small number, we get a very large number, and it can become unbounded. So if you implement the secant method, really you should put in some kind of test to make sure that things do not go out of hand. And so the algorithm for the secant method is essentially saying that xn plus 1, which is what we're saying for y, is going to equal xn minus f of xn divided by m. But then, of course, here we need to have xn minus f of xn, and then dividing by m is multiplying by 1 over m. So what we have here is you have xn minus 1 divided by f of xn minus f of xn minus 1. So we're keeping track of 2 points at every step, and those get updated over time. With the Newton-Raphson, we have to have an analytic gradient. We assume the existence of, we assume that df by dx is available analytically, and then we only need 1 point at each step. And so what we write is x at n plus 1 is equal to x at n minus f of x at n divided by f primed at x at n. And remember, of course, that f primed is equivalent to df by dx. The Newton-Raphson method has the advantage that you only need to specify a starting point, but it is, in a sense, even less bounded than the secant method. So again, you would need to think quite carefully about how to maintain the bounds. There is always the question of the tolerance, or the stopping criterion, if you prefer. You can potentially say that the magnitude of f of x must be less than some function, some amount delta, and that allows you to judge exactly where you've got to. You could argue for the secant method that you want the magnitude of a minus b to be less than some other small amount, epsilon. Those two are similar. It depends on whether you're worried about how close the 2 points are or the magnitude of your function. And of course, you should always have some kind of maximum iteration count. And for the secant and the Newton-Raphson, you also want an unbounded solution check. You know, some kind of check that you haven't gone wildly away from where the root might be. So that covers the background maths and concepts for the root finding algorithms that we've presented. In an accompanying video, I will go through the bisection method in particular, just showing how that updates and how